I'm in the midst of a sermon series. This is the second week, called Foundational Truths. If you happen to not be here last week, this is your first Sunday or your first Sunday in a while, welcome. We're glad you're here. You didn't miss anything you can't catch up on, I promise. And I'll give you a little snippet, a paragraph to catch you up. And people who came last week are going, wow, you could have done that in a paragraph? Why do we sit through that whole thing, right? I'm just giving them the Cliff Notes version. But what we're talking about are the essential foundational truths of the Christian faith. What is it that biblical Christians believe? And sometimes by nature, we're going to be drawing some lines and saying, hey, this is what we believe. This is what the Bible says. This is something we don't believe because it might be popular. And so today is kind of going to be one of those days. And I live in preacher world. And trust me, sometimes you don't want to live in preacher world. So it's just not a good place. Because Twitter is a dumpster fire. And I can't figure out if Tuesdays are panic day or if they're outrage day on Twitter. But, you know, it's one of the two all the time. But there was a statement made this week in preacher world that most of you probably didn't even see. And by the way, most of the time it's stuff that is insignificant. People get all riled up about things. You know how this works. Preachers are no different. They get all fired up about something that doesn't matter, and then it kind of burns out and goes away. But sometimes a statement is made or somebody does something that I think is significant and important, and it actually fit this morning. So I use this as a contrast, not to be critical, but to just contrast. This past week, Pope Francis was in Singapore, and he was being asked questions by some children. He was answering those questions, and a child asked Pope Francis for his view on if only Christians could know God and go to heaven, or if everybody, every religion led to God. So in all fairness to the Pope, I want to read what he said, but I do want you to understand I have a response to it. Here's what the Pope said, quote, "All religions are paths to reach God. They are, to make a comparison, like different languages, different dialects to get there. But God is God for everyone. If you start to fight saying, my religion is more important than yours, mine is true and yours isn't, where will this lead us? There is only one God, and each of us has a language to arrive at God. Some are Sikh, Muslim, Hindu, Christians. There are different ways to God." End quote. Now, that sounds good. As a matter of fact, I would say this. Many people want that to be true. They want to believe that because it sounds good, it sounds loving, it sounds unifying. You want to believe that. But if that statement is true, then none of the Old Testament makes sense. Like God saying, you shall have no other gods before me, and him punishing the nation of Israel when they worshiped gods, other gods, and went after other religions. That doesn't make any sense. God seems schizophrenic in the Old Testament if that's the case. Christmas is insignificant. Why would it matter that God sent a Savior into the world? Jesus died for absolutely no reason. He died the cruelest death that anyone has ever died on the planet. Crucifixion was a horrifying way to die. And if it was unnecessary because all religions lead to God, then Jesus died for no reason whatsoever. Easter is a fairy tale, if that is the case. The resurrection is just some fanciful story, and sin doesn't matter. Now, here's why I use that, because A.W. Tozer said it this way. What you think about when you think about God is the most important thing about you. Your understanding of who God is more important than anything else about you. It's more important than your ethnicity. It's more important than your socioeconomic background. It's more important than your education. It's more important than if you have athletic ability or musical ability. It's more important than where you're from. All the most important thing in life and what will condition every decision you will ever make is what you believe about God. If you believe there is no God, it will condition every decision you make. if you believe that the God of the Bible is God, it will condition every decision you make, and your beliefs will always impact your behavior. As a matter of fact, I would go farther. Your beliefs will dictate your behavior. No one can consistently behave in a way that contradicts what they believe deep in their soul. You can't do it. There is no way to do that. What you really believe is going to come out through your actions. So what you think about, when you think about God, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. Now, last week we established that the Bible, here's my paragraph, that the Bible is a historically accurate book. We have absolutely good evidence. As a matter of fact, I would go so far as to say that it is pretty much irrefutable that the Bible is a historically accurate book. We've learned that. The question is it a divinely inspired book? We read those verses. Is it really from God? Is it His Word? Is it His truth to us? And what we learned last week is this, that there is one thing that sets the Bible apart from all other religious books, and that is predictive prophecy that has been fulfilled. In other words, God said in the book, this is going to happen. 100 years later sometimes, this happened, just like God said. Only a God who knows everything can accurately predict the future. I was asked a question about that, by the way. I do want to say this. I was asked a question about a guy some of you have heard of named Nostradamus. If you've ever read Nostradamus, you'll understand something. What people say are his prophecies are some of the most vague, like they're not specific. People read into them. He said that, like people say, he predicted the rise of Hitler. He did not use the name Hitler in his writings. It didn't happen, okay? Read Nostradamus for yourself, and you will find out that he might be right about 25% of the time, and I would say to you that a blind squirrel will find an acorn about 25% of the time, okay? So there's that. But we learned that what really sets the Bible apart is predictive prophecy that is fulfilled, and only a God who knows the future could tell somebody 100 years before something happened, this is going to happen, and then it happens. And so we use that as it's great evidence that the Bible is the inspired Word of God. Having said that, now we want to know what the Bible says about God. And we're going to ask a few questions along the way and answer those. The first one's going to be, is there a God? Of course the Bible says there's a God. And He reveals Himself in Matthew chapter 3 in the most unique way. I want you to open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 3, verse 13. Yeah, I thought I'd forgotten about you. Matthew chapter 3, verse 13. It's pretty weak. I think you were like, does he want us to do it now? He got so far into the sermon. And we're going to talk about a moment in the Gospels where we see who God is. I mean, we see Him very clearly in this moment. It is one of the most unique portraits of God in the Bible where we really see Him. And here's where it happens. At the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, He's now an adult. We're way past Bethlehem. We're way past the growing up years. Jesus is now an adult, and He's probably about 30 years old. And the Bible says this is a moment that transpired as Jesus actually starts to become a public figure. He starts His ministry. This is sort of the inauguration of that. So Matthew chapter 3, verse 13. Then Jesus arrived from Galilee at the Jordan, coming to John. That's John the Baptist, not the apostle, but John the Baptist. And he says, he arrived coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, I have need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? But Jesus answering said to him, permit it at this time. For in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he permitted him. Verse 16. After being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. And behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of the heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And the first question that we would want answers to from the Bible, if we know it is an inspired book, is, does it really tell us there's a God? The answer to that question is obviously yes. I mean, you figured that one out already. I mean, you could have passed that test without studying, right? So you figured that out. But who does it tell us God is? What does it tell us God's like? And what this passage reveals to us is something about the nature of God that we need to understand. That God, there is one God who eternally reveals himself in three distinct persons. There is one God. We are monotheist. There is only one God. But he reveals himself for all eternity as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Father is God. Jesus the Son is God. The Holy Spirit is God. They are one God in three distinct persons. I do not exactly understand what I just told you, but I'm telling you it's in the book. I can't do it when it comes to an absolutely accurate description of this, of how it works, but it works. Now, let me tell you what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that the Father is God in the Old Testament, and then Jesus shows up as God in the Gospels, and then the Holy Spirit is God from Acts to now and into the future. That's called modalism, and it's heresy. You see, what we have in Matthew chapter 3 is a picture of God. The Holy Spirit is revealed. We have the revelation of the Spirit. The Spirit descends from heaven, and the Bible says it lights on Jesus. Now, when artists paint this, they always paint the dove on Jesus' shoulder. I don't know that. It seems accurate. It's better than being on his head. I mean, a bird on somebody's head is not profound. It's comic, right? So I think that's probably accurate. We have the proclamation of the Father when he says, "This is my beloved Son." I mean, who else could be saying that but the Father? So we have the Father speaking, and we obviously have Jesus who is being affirmed. We have the revelation of the Spirit. We have the proclamation of the Father. We have the affirmation of the Son. The Father says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And so what we see here is a picture that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are forever. Forever in the past, forever into the future. For all eternity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are the one eternal God. Now, what does the Bible say about God? What does the Bible say to give us some evidence of God? Well, the Bible says there are two revelations of God. There is what is called general revelation, and then there is specific revelation. General revelation goes something like this. David said in Psalm 8, verse 3 and 4, "When I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, the moon and stars which you have ordained, what is man that you take thought of him?" And then the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 1 says it this way, "Because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen." David in the Psalms, Paul in the New Testament say to us, look around you at the general revelation of the universe itself, of basically of nature itself. I love this particular illustration. I confess that I got it from Louis Giglio, if you guys ever listen or watch Louis Giglio. But he did this illustration in which he was talking about the greatness of God. And he said, imagine if the earth were the size of a golf ball, to get some sense of proportion. If the earth were the size of a golf ball, then the sun, the closest star to us, remember David says, "When I consider the work of your hands, the moon and the stars that you have ordained." So the sun is the closest star to us. If the earth was the size of a golf ball, the sun is a million times larger than the earth. That means the sun would be 15 feet in diameter. Golf ball Earth, 15 feet in diameter, flaming ball of nuclear fission, 93 million miles from us. But here's what's interesting about that. The sun is the perfect size to create a gravitational orbit for a planet the size of the Earth, 93 million miles or so, away from this sun that is constantly burning, that any closer it would burn to a cinder, any farther away it'd be a frozen ice ball. And God positioned it perfectly 93 million miles away for life to flourish on this planet. Now some people say, well, that just happened by random chance. Then why doesn't it happen by random chance other places? Why isn't it reproduced? And the reason is that order does not come from chaos. Order comes from an orderly mind. In order for there to be this designed creation, if we see design and intricacy in creation, then there had to be a designer. When you see a portrait of someone and it actually looks like them, you know there had to be a painter. Now, I've been to some art museums and I've seen some paintings and I'm like, I don't know, that does look random, right? But when you see a painting and it actually looks like a person, you know there's a painter. The classic illustration is the clock. If there's a clock, the pieces shouldn't just fly together. There has to be a clockmaker. But even beyond that, I think when David says, when I consider the heavens, the moon, the stars that you have ordained, what is man that you take thought of him? I think David must have had in his mind something that you could see this afternoon if it's clear. Just about sunset, just go outside and look to the west. Nobody paints the sky like God does, and he does it every night. Some people don't see beauty in where we live. I didn't used to either. I mean, come on, it's kind of flat. I'd like a few hills and a few trees that are taller than a shrub brush, right? Okay, I confess. But there is nothing like a West Texas sunset. It shows the glory of God and his handiwork every single day that we're here. So there is general revelation that tells us the intricacy of creation, the complexity of life. It all tells us that, yes, there's a God. But then there is specific revelation. And that specific revelation is that God has revealed his truth. And God has revealed all that he is in his son, Jesus. Now, will we ever understand all that he is? Not in this life, at least, because the finite brain cannot conceive the infinite God. But he's shown us everything we need to know. And the revelation of God, the ultimate revelation of God, is the testimony of Jesus Christ in the Word of God. Everything we know about Jesus, credibly know about Jesus, is found in this book. And Jesus is the revelation of the one true living God, so that we can see, that we can hear, that we can understand who God is and what it takes to please him, to know him. So, what we have in this passage that I just read is the Father speaking, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." He is affirming the deity of the Son. I'm going to get to that next week. There's no way I can plow that ground today. Trust me, next week we're going to talk about Jesus a little bit more in detail. So is there a God? The Bible would affirm absolutely there is. He is one God in three persons. We call that a Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So then we get to the whole concept of, well, okay, which God is God? And the reason I phrase it that way is this, that, okay, there are these other religions, and they have a very different picture or portrait of God than what I just painted for you and what the Bible paints for you. For example, If the God of Islam is God, then it can't be true that the God of the Bible is God. I mean, they're just totally opposite personalities if you read both books. Both things can't be true. I realize that in our world today, we want to do this thing where, well, that's your truth and I got my truth. Let me tell you, sometimes there's the truth. Sometimes there's just the truth. You know what? If all of you tomorrow say, you know what, Bob, you're wrong about this. You know what I'm going to tell you? I'll be the lone voice saying, nope, you're wrong. Sometimes just stand for the truth, people. Just stand for the truth. And you don't have to be mean about it and mad about it. And sometimes I do get a little fired up about it, but I'm not mad at you. But sometimes you just got to say, look, this is right and this is wrong because the Bible says so, because God says so. Our culture doesn't respect that anymore. I get that. But for us who are followers of Jesus, somewhere along the way, we have to take a stand. So let me talk about this for just a minute. What does the Bible say? Well, the Bible, the inspired word of God, says there's only one God. Here's what the Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 60. That all the peoples of the earth may know that the Lord, that's Yahweh, the one true God of the Old Testament, revealed in the Old Testament, is God. There is no other. I mean, that's just straightforward and simple. This is not complicated theology. There is one God. You say, but Bob, what about all these other gods? Well, Paul addressed that in the book of 1 Corinthians. He says, there may be so-called gods, both in heaven and on earth, and some people may actually worship many gods and many lords. But for us, there is one God and Father, the Father, by whom all things were created and for whom we live. There is one God. He reveals himself as a Father. Look at that next line. By whom all things were created and for whom we live. And there is one Lord, Jesus Christ. Look at the next two lines. Through whom all things were created and through whom we live. The same language is used to describe Jesus as the Father in that passage of Scripture. You say, but what about the false gods that Paul was talking about there? I mean, Paul was living in a world where they worshiped basically the Greek pantheon of gods. So are those really gods? And Paul says, look, people worship so-called gods, but they're not real. They're just stone. And there's not a real God behind them. But here's the truth. If there is a spiritual force behind it, it is a counterfeit God. It is a counterfeit God. As a matter of fact, I would go so far as to say this. Satan is a liar. And his greatest deception on planet Earth was to convince people of false gods. It is a demonic deception intended to lead people away from the truth of the gospel. And here's how we know that. The Bible says there's one way to know God. It is by his grace through faith. That's the only way to know God. Every other religion in the world is over here on the other side saying, you got to work your way to God. You got to do good works. You got to kill people in the name of your God. You have to do all these things. All the other religions of the world are do. They are works. You have to do something. Christianity is, it was done by the completed work of Christ on the cross. I mean, this is a contrast, folks. You can't get away from that. You can't blend these things together, no matter how hard you try and make it make any sense. So this one God reveals himself in these three persons. Jesus even affirmed that in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now here's what I want you to hear in that verse. You're like, I've heard that verse over and over. Like every time we baptize somebody, right? We say, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I want you to think about that. Jesus said those words. And in that statement, he put himself on the same level with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Jesus affirmed the Trinity. So we know that that's what God has done for us. We know that's who God is. But I do want to contrast one thing because I'm going to really work on helping you understand the identity and the deity and the humanity of Jesus next week. It's pretty complicated too. Sorry. Sometimes we have to do hard things. And then we're going to do the Holy Spirit, which everybody's confused about that, right? So we'll do that the next week, so that'll be fun. But I do want to talk about the Father for a few minutes because I think the Father sometimes gets a bad rap. And I want to say this. The Father loves you. See, here's the bad rap I think the Father gets. That sometimes people see the Father as the stern, rule-making, judge of the Trinity. And he's like, I see what you did, and I'm going to zap you with a lightning bolt. Or I see what you did, and I'm going to make your car break down, you know, or something like that. And people just see God in this judgmental mentality, the Father. And then they see Jesus is like, oh, no, Dad, don't do that. I'll take care of them. They're my, you know, like Jesus, you hear those passages about Jesus interceding for us with the Father, and you're like, Jesus is like the referee in the fight. And the Holy Spirit, we don't know what he's doing. But anyway, we're totally confused on that. I want you to listen to me. The Father loves you. God is love. You know what that means? The Father is love. The Son is love. The Spirit is love. The Father loves you. The Cherokee Indians had a tradition, and they still have. When a boy became a man, they had a rite of passage. It was called a vision quest. And part of the vision quest, I don't understand it all, but part of it was that a young boy who's becoming a man would be blindfolded, led deep into the woods, told to sit down, and he had to stay there all night. I'd stay there all night. But he's blindfolded. He has nothing with him, no weapon, nothing. So he's sitting there. It's dark and it's quiet, and the wind blows a few leaves, and he thinks, man, there's a predator. There's an animal that's going to kill me, you know? Or then in the middle of the night, he hears a twig break, right? I mean, every sound, he thought, I'm about to be, like, eaten by some wild animal, or I'm about to be killed. He was told he had to keep the blindfold on all night. But you know this, even if you've been blindfolded, you can tell when it's dark and when it's light. And so they told him, when you begin to sense that there's a little more light, you know, around the blindfold, when you feel the warmth of the sun, you can take the blindfold off. So this boy sits in the woods all night long, hearing those sounds and being paranoid and being concerned. He sits there. Finally, he feels the warmth of the sun. And he would take the blindfold off. And when he took the blindfold off, he would see the silhouette of a man toward the sun, always toward the sun. He would see the silhouette of a man, and then the man was moving toward him. He thought, oh, no, that's who it is. He's going to come kill me. And as he got closer, he would see the face of his Father. You see, it was the Father who had been there all night long, watching over him, and he didn't know it. There is a Father who loves you, and he watches over your life, and sometimes you don't even know it. You don't know he's there, but he loves you, and he wants what is best for you. Now I'm going to do one thing. Point number three got really long, and so I'm going to fly through it. If you drop your pen and you're a note taker, you're going to miss five attributes of God. So what is this one true God really like? Let me give you, I think I have 12 of these. First of all, God is omnipresent. God is everywhere. God is not bound by space. You can call on him anywhere you are. David says, if I go to the farthest reaches of the universe, you're there. If I go to the deepest cave, you're there. If I go to the grave, you're there. God is everywhere. God is omniscient. God knows everything. Why would you worship a God that didn't know everything? I mean, if he's trying to figure it out along with us, we're in trouble. He's omnipotent. God has the absolute power and authority to do anything he chooses. God has the ability to change anything he chooses to change. Now, there is one thing that God cannot do. He cannot violate his character. He cannot violate his holy character. So God is truth. He cannot lie or be mistaken. Now, every one of us parents have had this moment, right? You tell your kids we're going to do something, and circumstances change. And you have to go back to your kids and say, we're not going to be able to do that. And every time, I've heard it, you've heard it, you lied. No, you didn't lie. You might have been mistaken or just a situation that happened out of your control, right? God has never been mistaken, and he does not lie. He always tells the truth. God is good. God seeks to provide the very best for his children. Now, when we say God is good, that doesn't mean that God's going to give us what we want. It means that God is always moving our lives and orchestrating our lives to provide what we need. And what we need may not be what we see that we need. God is love. That is his unconditional and sacrificial care that he shows toward humanity. God is holy. He is morally pure, completely separate from evil. God is righteous. He is morally right in all of his ways. Everything he does is right. I don't use this often, but I'm going to tell you. When I was younger, those of you who've been to lunch with a pastor, you've heard my testimony that my first wife died in a car accident. There was an African-American pastor in our town, black pastor in our town, and I knew him. I'd known him for a long time. And he came over to me. He said, Bob, I want to tell you something. God is God, and God is good, and what he does is right. And I've never forgotten those three statements. God is God. He's in control. God is good, and what he does is right. And it may be hurtful for us in a moment, but what he does is right. God is just. God is fair and impartial in all his dealings with humanity. God does not play favorites. God does not play favorites based on the color of skin or the continent you were born on. God does not play favorites by our background. God is impartial. God is jealous. And this is one that trips people up. That's why I wanted to put it in. God has an intense, passionate commitment to his people, reflecting his desire for their exclusive worship. God's not going to share his glory with anybody. He is a jealous God. He is wrathful. This is God's intense, eternal, righteous anger towards sin and evil. Here's the contrast. Some people want to say God is love, but they don't want to say God is wrathful. He is both. That is not an inconsistency. God is eternal. He is not subject to time, and God is immutable. He does not change. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6 says, "For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, O sons of Jacob, you are not consumed." In other words, if I changed my mind, I'd just zap you all. That's what he's saying in that passage. But he says, I don't change. We serve a God who is unchanging. And that is who he is. But here's the beautiful picture. You can know the one true eternal God of the universe. You can know him. And you can know him through a relationship with his son. Not being religious, not being a part of a church, this church, not even by being baptized. Baptism is a symbol you do know him, but you only can know him by faith in Jesus, trusting that what he did on the cross paid the price for your sin, trusting that he was raised from the dead so that you could spend forever in eternity with him. You can know the one true God of the universe. And if you want to know him, I want to give you an opportunity. Our pastors are going to be here at the front in just a few minutes. And if you'd like to know God, here's your day. It's really that simple. It's not that hard. There are not a lot of hoops to jump through. You just have to trust him. And so we're going to sing a song in just a moment after I pray. And then our pastors will be here at the front. And if you want to know God, you come. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for this moment. And we will trust you with it. I pray for those who've come today. And today is that day that they want to know you. And my prayer for them today is that you will move in their hearts and draw them to salvation in Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.